She's upset. This is the show where Ohio froze down. Of course, I am the one and only Daniel Diesel. I'm with my guest co-host, Roly Poly. He's in the house.
What up, guys?
Yes, what up? Yes, we're here live in Dayton, Ohio on the campus of Wright State University. And yes, I'm waving to my people, but this is Ohio's on Fire. And tonight, I got a guest interview with horror movie director Shawn Burkett. Also, he's bringing his actress, the actor and actress who's in the movie. Of course, the movie was Do Not Fornicate in the Woods. And the actors are Brittany Blanton and Scott Gillespie. But those three will be on the show tonight around 6:30-ish. We will have a nice interview. We'll talk about horror movies, scary movies, music, and the supernatural. See what's going on in this world. They got some interesting thoughts. So they will be on about 6:30-ish, 6:35. Of course, now we're playing Halloween music to celebrate them being here. For the record, I was supposed to do the Cincinnati, Ohio Showcase. I had a bit of a loading issue on the computer that I used to help look these up, and I couldn't do it properly this week. I do apologize for that, because the Cincinnati Showcase was supposed to be part of Dayton Indie Music Madness for my qualifying, so I got to be able to do it properly, which I wasn't planning on doing those every week. I'm going to do them for many weeks during the during this portion of Ohio's on Fire, their next several months. But I will do the Cincinnati Showcase next Tuesday night. But we're going to do something cool, though, with the Halloween music. So listen to that in between my talking segments. So anyway, but let's talk about some fun stuff that happened this weekend. Jacob, did you have some fun this week? I mean, Roly Poly, did you have some fun this weekend?
Yeah, I actually had a lot of fun. I went to my grandpa's wedding reception. He just got married to, I guess you could say, my now my step-grandma.
Okay.
And, you know, I hung out with some friends, went and saw them, you know, just go back to my town and see the people I haven't seen for a while now. And basically that was the highlight of my weekend.
Absolutely. Well, I know Patriot Pat, he went to wedding himself also this weekend, so I hope that was a lot of fun. But I'll share some of the things I did this weekend. Back on Friday, I did indeed attend the Dayton Music Arts Film Festival, and it was over parts of Dayton, Ohio. I got to see this for myself. They had it over at, there was the East Canal Street Tavern. It was over, they had one over there, and they had it over in the Oregon District. There was two other bars. There was, of course, Blind Bob's and the Oregon Express. And there's a lot of potential. There were people at all these bars. Of course, it's loud rock music. I checked out. I got to see Man Ray. As you saw, no, Man Ray was on my show last week. And really cool guys. And they rocked it. I actually got some pictures of them, which I'll try to get uploaded eventually. But Man Ray really rocked it. I saw them. I saw Good English. And then I went over to the Blind Bob's. Of course, the guy that's running the Dayton Music Arts Film Festival, Connor Stratton, his band, the Speaking Sons, they performed. They performed a nice 45-minute set. And, of course, they did a live version of the Disenchanted, which me and Roly Poly love very much. Really good stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, but they did a live version of that. Actually, at one point, there was this lady. She'd been drinking quite a bit. She did a little bit of a stage dive during that song. It's a good tune. People went nuts over it.
Mosh pitting and stuff?
Yeah. Well, not, I don't know about extreme mosh pitting.
Okay, that's good.
Up towards, well, yeah. Yeah, it could have broken some glasses there, but in the front area, they were jumping up and down a little, and of course, the lady did a little stage dive, but that was it. It was nothing too out of control, if you will. So, there was that, and then also Forrest Green and the Forrest Green Band. They have a guy that plays the saxophone along with the guitar music. It's really good. It was rock and soul mixed into one, so that was a good mixture. So anyway, so that was what I did on Friday. Now Saturday afternoon, I went over to the annual event, Cincinnati Comic Expo. It's a place where you can meet up with classic celebrities and buy a lot of comic books. I did it this past Saturday. I saw a bunch of celebrities. I'll tell you what I did. I'll tell you what I did really poorly. There's a celebrity line. Of all the media guests that they have, they were all lined up in one little row. You can get in lines. And, of course, Burt Ward was there, Adam West. Those two were there. And Madam West by far had the longest line. A lot of people really wanted to see him. And that was cool. And but there are a few other lines that's a lot easier to get through. Even if you didn't buy a picture or you didn't get a picture op, you were able to talk to these celebrities. They were more than happy to talk to you for free. And I got to talk to Iron Zine. He was from Beverly Hills 90210. Of course, he's in the Sharknado films.
Oh, God.
So I talked to him briefly. He was like, it was good to meet you. I was a little starstruck because I was surrounded by all these famous media people.
Right.
And also, if you remember Back to the Future 2, the three characters from those films, you had the lady that was Michael J. Fox's girlfriend, and then also James Tolkien was there, and Harry Walters Jr. He was the guitarist in the band for at the prom during Back to the Future 1 and 2. I did something really cool. I was thinking, if I have to get my autograph, my book signed by somebody, and beware, these autographs, everyone charges, so you gotta have a budget for these events. I decided to go see James Tolkien, and it was like, I think $40, but anyway, I talked to him. I told him to sign, "You're a Slacker, Daniel," and then he did it, too. And I was so thrilled. I was the only thing I could think of. All the quotes I could think of out of all the celebrities, I was thinking about him when he said, "You're a Slacker." He wrote my book, so I'll keep that book forever. And so he signed that quote, and then he signed his name. That was awesome. He even said it after he wrote it. He looked at me. He said it with love, too. He was like, "You're a slacker, Daniel." And usually the word slacker ain't a great term, but with James Tolkien, though, he said it with love. Like, I think he's probably done that to hundreds of fans that requested it.
Oh, yeah.
That was my request. James Tolkien, and I saw the two original Power Rangers. It was David Yost and Austin St. John.
Wow.
I saw them, and they had a panel, and Christina Long had a panel. It was good fun. And also, he wasn't part of the festivities, but since I read first baseman Sean Casey and his family were there, so I actually saw him, and that was really cool.
Nice.
Because I'm a big fan of his when I was a kid, and that was a surprise because he wasn't on the bill. He was just there with his family hanging out, checking out the festivities. So anyway, that's what I did Saturday. Then I attended the Xenia Community Festival in my hometown. They have a little. It's the second year they've done this. They have a little something where they have bands tribute bands that play music from the 50s and 80s. They play the classics, which that's typical of Xenia. I think we usually, when we do have a celebration, we celebrate music from the past. I think Xenia is more geared towards the older family, which that's fine. I mean, it's a nice little small community. And for a while, we didn't have anything over at Shawnee Park. But for the second year now, we were doing this Xenia Festival. Booths, they had... And by the way, I want to give a shout-out. This is really rare that I do this. But there's a food booth that they have there. It was called the Barbecue Pork Stand, where they make sandwiches. It's a homemade-owned company. They've had booths all over Ohio for like last 30 years. Well, the guy that runs it, he is retiring, and they're deciding to close down the business. So they are going out of business, which is a shame. He had really good sandwiches. So shout out to them. Thank you for your years of services, because they're going away after they do a few more of these festivals. They are going away. So shout out. You had good stuff.
Radio station that will admit that we love our mom.
Barely. All right. I am Daniel Diesel, and I'm with Roly Poly, my shadow and guest host and good friend. And we are here live on Ohio's on Fire. There's a little bit Shawn Burkett's coming up, and it's going to be a good time. There's people out there walking past us in this beautiful green hallway. Unbelievable.
Indeed.
So anyway, I think it's now time for everyone's favorite segment. It is now time for OMVP, and that stands for Ohio's Most Valuable Pedestrian. The beautiful stars in the sky. All right, but Ohio's on Fire's OMVP goes to someone that did something interesting, and they either live in Ohio or they visited Ohio, and it can either be a person, group of people, Or it could be non-human. It could be a mundane object, because a few weeks ago I gave it to drones. So it could be something that's not even a living matter. But but let's get to MVP, and I got to get to this article. Butler County Sheriff's deputy arranges hotel stay while family looks for a new home. But this was over in Oxford, Ohio. If not for a Butler County Sheriff's deputy, a local mother and her two children might have found themselves sleeping on the street. Tara Gray never thought she would find herself homeless, but recently she said her landlord evicted her, along with her two young sons, after she missed the rent payment. Since, she said, they have bounced from friends to family to church members' homes. Now, finally, they turned to the Butler County Sheriff's Office for help, where they were met with blankets and allowed to stay in the lobby overnight after only to close having to close on their back. The next morning, Gray was approached by Deputy Brian Bessel, and he said this. I'm thinking he's going to... Oh, I'm sorry. It was the lady, Tara Gray, she says, I'm thinking he's going to say, you guys can't be here any longer. You have to find someplace else. But that's not what Bessel had in store for Gray and her children. Instead, he arranged for three to have as many as 10-day stay at a hotel while Gray looks for a new place to live. Not only that, Gray said both Bessel also helped arrange for new clothes and shoes for the boys, as well as stocking them up on food. In the Facebook post Monday, she doesn't know what she would have done and said, no one sees the good in our officers. But that's good to hear. Here in Gray's full, unedited Facebook post relating to the story in her own words, the post was accompanied by the above photo. He says that, you know how good God is. God was blessed in us this week. I don't know what I would have done. This officer, Brian Bessel from Butler County Sheriff's Department, has truly blessed me and my family. I'll read one more sentence because it's a really long statement. We are homeless, and Saturday night we slept inside the Butler County jail lobby with the clothes we had on our back and nowhere else to go. Officer Holly got us blankets, and I watched my kids sleep. When the morning came, Officer Brian Bessel brought me and my boys in his office and arranged for us to be placed in a hotel for 10 days and took us out to get all new clothes. And that is good. That is really cool of him to do that. So it is proof that not all cops are bad. I know that you're getting a bad rep lately for having these little riots, and I'm having issues with civil rights and police brutality. But this guy seems like a good guy. And of course, that is...
I mean, that just goes to prove, Dan, that people want to believe that all cops are bad just because of all the stuff that's been going on lately. But this proves right now that not all cops are corrupt or quote unquote.
That's right. So what a cool thing he did. You know what? Not only is Deputy Brian Bessel a hero, he's a good cop, and he helped that family for a tough time. And you know what? He's something else. It's not a real award, but it's a shout out to people who are cool in Ohio. So Deputy Brian Bessel, you are OMVP. And that stands for Ohio's Most Valuable Pedestrian. We are live on Ohio's on Fire. I am Daniel Diesel along with Roly Poly. And I got my guests for tonight. They are two incredibly talented people. I got horror movie actor Shawn Burkett, and it's been a long time coming, sir. And we also have Brittany Blanton. She is an actress on the rise. She's here. Say hello, guys.
Hey. Hello.
Hello. All right. So welcome. Now, I have to ask you guys, I'm curious, do we live alone?
I do not live alone. I live with my boyfriend and my dog.
Well, I kind of meant it in a different way, as in, are we haunted by ghosts, or is there aliens in the sky?
That works too.
That works though. That one first.
We'll talk after the show, but yeah. But what do you think about ghosts and aliens?
I don't. Honestly, I feel that I could put more stock behind aliens than ghosts. I kind of feel that way. I mean, especially some of the weird things that have been happening in the sky over the world lately. Like, people are seeing these, like, not like portals, but like just weird stuff in the sky. Crazy stuff.
Okay, absolutely. I think we don't live alone. I like to think that there's things that we can't understand that's out there in outer space.
Kind of like life on other planets and stuff. That is like, what the heck is that?
Well, we had life on Mars once. It's already been proven. So, yeah, I like to think there's something out there. But now I want to ask, why are people obsessed with blood and guts, like in film or the media in general?
I'm not sure how to answer that. I mean, real life blood and guts versus movie blood and guts. I think it's one of those things that people, they can't help themselves. It's like seeing a grisly car accident. It's, you want to know what's going on, but then once you see it, then you're kind of, I wish I wouldn't have looked. You did. It's, I think it's more of a game of curiosity.
Okay. Brittany, any thoughts?
I mean, probably the same.
Okay. you concur.
Just take my answer.
All right. Now, I think Roly Poly wants to ask you some.
Yes.
Yes, yeah. He wants to ask you some. Yeah, you're...
My question is, what's the difference between a good indie horror film and a major market film? Like with the film you're creating being an indie film compared to like something like Halloween or Friday the 13th, one of those market horror films that have been around for like ever.
I mean, technically, those were independent films.
Hey,
you
got me there.
Me too.
It's basically depends on your budget. I believe, I can't remember what the standards are at the moment, but I know within the last 10 years, if your film, if the budget was under $1 million, it was considered an independent film.
Right.
John Carpenter's Halloween is one of my all-time favorite films ever. The German cinematography is just beautiful. It's the slow angles that creates suspense.
Right.
But yeah, they done that. I want to say they ended up, I could be way, way off track, but I believe it was under $500,000 when they first made that.
I remember watching a biography on the entire movies, and yeah, I believe it was somewhere around the 100,000 eras.
Yeah.
So somewhere around there. So yeah, you could be right. So basically, since you just mentioned that Halloween was like your all-time favorite horror movie, another question I have is, was that the movie that inspired you, like John Carpenter? Was he the guy who inspired you to be a director now? Like of the horror genre?
Yes and no. But as far as directors, yes. John Carpenter was the first director that caught my eye, that I admired. Just the way he chose to shoot that film with the, like I said, with the German cinematography, it just, that got me hooked. It's like, I probably didn't see that film until I was, probably 16.
Really?
And it's one of those things that at 16, I'm not sure what year that would have been. I believe like 99 or 2000 maybe.
Okay.
You know, it still had, at that day and age, it still had a horrible feeling on me. Like, it actually scared me.
Right.
That's something that is very far and few between with horror movies. Anymore, it's just about
blood and guts.
Blood and guts and some big loud noise to scare you.
Right.
Uh-huh.
And speaking of Halloween, how did you feel about Rob Zombie's, his version of both the first and the second original Halloweens?
I admire the first one. I really liked about the first 10 minutes of the second one. It really has nothing against it's really nothing against Rob Zombie. It's just,
you should have touched it.
It's basically, I mean, have you read up on why he did the things he did?
Yeah, I read up basically why he wanted to try to go for and what he did for Halloween 2.
Yeah, I mean, basically he was...
I've seen it. He wanted to be more about... It was more focused on Michael Myers than the other people.
Yeah.
I have seen them both.
But, I mean, he basically was... He had to make the first one to somebody else's standards.
Yeah.
That way he could be more artistic with the second one. I'm just not a fan of the second one. I admire it as an art piece. I completely understand the aspect he was going for it. Mm-hmm. But he just, I don't know, I'm not a fan of movies that leave the ending unfinished.
That's a thing, I think, what everyone thought about, the people who've seen Rob Zombie's Halloween 2 thought about. Personally, as a fan of Halloween, the franchise itself, I've seen them all. From the beginning of John Carpenter's to Rob Zombie's, I personally believe, and this is my opinion, that when he should not have touched it because he was completely off of the storyline. Because, and if you remember from Halloween 2, the original, it was all in a hospital, and then now this one was just everywhere. And I think what he was trying to go for was more of the Devil's Rejects kind of theme. Like, you know, all about the, maybe this will be scary because there's blood and guts everywhere and this guy's big, tall, and really creepy.
Yes. I mean, he kind of had the Devil's Rejects touch on the first one, which I liked. He kind of, you know, took it out of suburbia and put a little bit of trailer trash in it.
Oh, yeah. I agree.
Because that's one thing I think John Carpenter, that everyone was suspenseful for. I was like, wait a minute. Why was Michael like this? You know, what made him go to this? Then that's what Rob Zombie clicked in his head. It's like, what if I tell the story of why Michael Myers is how he became who he is?
Yeah, which, I mean, that was a great thing. I mean, that he basically bypassed 3 or 4 movies.
Yeah. It's like, whoa. That's
in the first 20 minutes of that film.
Yeah. Now, you guys have a cult favorite. It's all about making Whoopi in the woods, as they say. Now, where'd you guys film this at, and how were you able to get the license to do some of the scenes that you did that had the sexual graphic content?
Thankfully, we are shooting all on private property.
Okay.
so that's one of the big things as far as in the woods. We're actually still filming, though. We've had reshoots, and this coming weekend will be our final weekend of shooting.
Okay. Very exciting. Absolutely. So when will But when will it be released and in full?
At the moment, that is a very good question. People who have pre-ordered, or anybody who pre-orders, will get a copy of it by October 20th.
Okay. Oh, cool. Well, I'd say they just this is a film you've been talking about on your social media page for years. People, it has a cult following, even though it hasn't been fully released. I mean, there's trailers and stuff. It's been talked about a lot within this circle. So I like to. I think if it does, when people do finally get this thing, there should be a lot of excitement.
Yeah.
So
I have another question.
Hey, go ahead, man.
Oh yeah, sorry. What do you think about the director Eli Roth and his upcoming movie, The Green Inferno? Like, what do you think of his aspect of horror and indie films?
Eli Roth, that's a...
it's for both of you, so you know you can both chime in if you're familiar with it.
Yeah, chime in, Brittany.
Let's hear you chime in on Eli Roth, Brittany.
Yeah, say some, Brittany.
Come on, Brittany. Do you know who Eli Roth is, Brittany?
Shut up.
Brittany is completely green to anything horror. So,
no pun intended for that, so, by the way.
All right.
But Eli Roth, I'm trying to think of the last movie I saw of his that wasn't He Presents or something he produced.
Right.
I was a fan of The Werewolf in Hemlock Grove.
Right.
That was a surprisingly good transformation.
I've seen that.
Oh, so. You've seen that.
Yeah.
But The Green Inferno, I mean, I'm looking forward to it. It's kind of a, I don't know what he was going for, and I haven't really read up on it, but it's almost like a modern day take of Cannibal Holocaust.
Pretty much.
Except,
yeah.
I think he goes at it a different way with, aren't they like missionaries or?
Yeah, I think they're like these missionaries that are going to try to spread the word to this tribe that they have no idea about.
Yeah.
And then you end up finding out, well, oh wait, these are tribes and a bunch of cannibals.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
I want to know, on your downtime, do you enjoy violent video games or things that alludes to violent activity? But that's something that's not against the law, of course.
I do.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, he said he doesn't play video games that much. But pretty much I just like Call of Duty a lot.
Pretty good. Zombies. Awesome game, yes.
Yeah, but usually just the Black Ops 2.
Now I got one more question before we go to commercial and play music. What famous movie actor actress would you like to see in a horror film that hasn't been one yet and watch die?
What's your least favorite actor? You can go with that.
Oh, that's cool. I'm trying to think now because I don't know her name.
Okay. I think she's trying to duck out of it.
Yeah. Give me another movie.
No, I really don't know her name.
is. You're bad at movies.
Like what?
Scarlett Johansson has never been killed in a horror movie.
I would not want to.
She's been in
die.
Horror movies, mm-hmm. but she's never died.
We shouldn't want her to die.
I mean, I don't want her to die, but I feel that, you know, she's kind of tackled every angle in acting except some death.
Yeah.
Oh, Kristen Stewart. Do not like her.
Yes. There you go. We are back live with Ohio's on Fire. I am with my guest, Shawn Burkett. He is a horror movie director. And Brittany. Yes, she is here. So anyway, we're going to play a game. It is Truth or Dare. We've done this many times on the show. It's a family-friendly version of it because there's limitations. What's going to happen is that we will go around and ask each other Truth or Dare, where I'll ask Shawn. Shawn will ask Brittany. Brittany will ask Roly-Poly, and Roly-Poly will ask me. And so we'll have that. And then after that, we'll have some additional questions and shout-outs. So anyway, I'm going to begin. Mr. Shawn Burkett, truth or dare?
Let's go with, okay, let's go with dare.
Dare? I'll be simple. I dare you to mark a line on either side of your face with this marker.
Okay.
All right. On either side.
He's putting on his war paint, ladies and gentlemen.
Can I do both sides?
Yes, you can. I said
war paint.
Because my hat intimidates people walking through the halls. So now
that's awesome.
See, there you go.
Oh, Brittany's going to chime in.
Don't make me a cat. Why are you making me a cat?
You're some director.
Scotty, help.
beam him up, Scotty.
All right.
Remember, you're next.
Yes, next part. She's in trouble now.
Okay. Truth or dare?
Sure, dare. Why not?
Oh, dare? I dare you to take this marker. Here, hold this. Hold the marker. And go write your phone number on Roly-Poly's head.
Oh!
What?
That seems kind of like a dare for him.
That does seem like a dare for him. Oh, God.
Look at you.
Right.
Oh, you can't even read it. My handwriting sucks.
I feel you.
That's fine.
And it's hard to write on someone's head.
Yeah.
Now, for legal purposes, unless without her permission, I can't give out this number on the air, which I can't read it anyway. It looks like there's a zigzag. It's not even numbers. It just looks like a bunch of assorted shapes.
Oh, boy.
But now you got to ask him this. It's not done yet. Oh, yeah, truth or dare.
Truth or dare.
Well, let's just keep the streak going. Dare.
Okay. You said you'd help me.
There, okay. Let me see. All right, unless you think of something, let's see. You gotta ask him to dare something. He said dare, so there's three choices. There's smell your sock, like take off your sock and smell it. Then there's sing your favorite song for 30 seconds in a funny voice. Or roll around on the floor for 10 seconds, like a baby.
All of these are three choices. Can I pick?
Well, you can only do one. It's got you can only.
I can't like combine them into one.
Well, you could. Yeah, you can do that.
Oh, can you roll around on the floor and sing your favorite song?
In a funny voice.
Oh God!
All right, I'll broadcast this.
Yeah, this is actually happening, ladies and gentlemen.
Sing wild.
Oh God! That's my favorite song.
Yeah. What the?
It better not be by the Wiggles.
Think of your favorite artist and think of that song.
Wow, that's a hard one.
Yes, he's on the floor right now. He's going to do this. He's going to sing a song.
Okay, I got you. So, silly voice.
Yes.
Oh, God. Company, always on the run. Something. I got it. It's company until the day I die.
He did it! Yes, hey.
Woo.
Round of applause.
Bad company.
My Five Finger Death Punch version. Thank you.
Oh my God.
Give me Five Finger Death Punch. I have this horrible. I know.
No, that was like awful.
All right.
I needed that. Oh man.
Yeah, but I'm glad you're impressed. All right, Dan.
All right.
Truth or dare?
All right, dare.
Give me the marker. Oh, jeez. Top lock.
Now he's fucking high out.
I dare you to put your number on Brittany's head.
Ooh.
Are you okay with that?
Can I say, okay, yeah, I'm fine.
Yeah, all right. Film it.
I'm filming
it. And talk about it. Oh,
boy.
Well, this is the happiest day of my life.
He feels like famous now.
You don't. Yeah, gotta get it deep through all that makeup.
Yeah. All the blush.
You're like carving.
Okay, I got.
Head.
I'm sorry.
No, I'm just kidding. It's fine.
Right.
Save it for the movie theaters.
I'm doing it now. Let's see.
It looks more like a grocery list. No, I'm kidding.
This pen sucks.
No, it's probably barely legible in my head.
Okay. That last number is a 2, but I won't reveal the rest of it.
Dash. Looks good. Anyway, there you go.
Yeah, well, there you go. That's my artwork.
And masterpiece.
That was a video.
Oh, smooth.
Okay, that's not how we do a selfie.
That's not how you take a selfie.
Yes, they're taking a selfie of this great moment. Because, yes, Sean's got a cat face, and Brandy's got my number on her forehead.
And I'm sitting over here with her number on my forehead.
Yes.
Pretty soon we'll have everybody's number.
There's no calling. That's against the rules.
So we have a few more questions about this film that's going to be coming out eventually. Who else is in this film besides Brittany? Of course, you're the director, Sean. Who else is in it that we should be aware of?
Well, Scott Gillespie. Scott Gillespie, he's been with... He's been the wind beneath my wings since 2011.
Okay.
And Scott's one of my good friends. He's always down to do something. Scott's in the film as a character, and he plays the creature.
Mm-hmm.
Brandy Mason, she's been in a lot of things by Troma.
Yeah.
Heather Nadia White. Nadia White, I have to use her professional name. Hannah Hurt, Brian Cornell. That's really it for the main cast.
Yeah.
We have great makeup artists. Hannah Hurt and Ryan Stacey are doing makeups for the film and special effects. And then Roman Josart.
Yeah.
And Derek, I don't remember your last name. I believe it's like Hummel. Hummel, maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know, and I don't have time to look it up on my phone.
Okay.
Roman's, he's been our camera guy for the last few shooting dates. He's amazing.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And his buddy Derek has came out, and he's our gaffer. He does awesome lighting. I'm not going to lie, they've completely saved this project, and it's awesome. What they do is awesome.
That's always good.
And then there's my first AD, Lou. She lives in Florida, so she's been flying back and forth to do this. And she's a trooper. She likes to give me a lot of headache. But
she's great.
She kind of keeps me in line.
Awesome. Now, when people do finally watch this movie, what do you hope that they get out of this? What's your vision?
As a person, as a filmmaker, I mean, people tend to judge you. They judge you by, the way you look. I mean, everybody's judgmental to an extent, but people hear the title of this film and they automatically think that it's going to be a very adult film.
And it's not. It's not a pornography, for those that know the real name of this film.
Exactly. It actually... basically it tells you not to do this in the woods.
Yes.
I mean, there are consequences if you do this. But, honestly, we've went to horror conventions and, I mean, we've passed out, condoms.
Uh-huh.
I mean, for the film, like, you know, everybody is just really, really against the film just because of the name. And it's not going to be some raunchy thing. It's, I mean, there's a plot. There's a storyline.
Uh-huh.
And it's similar to storylines that have been heard before. And nobody jumped on some bandwagon against those movies.
All right. Now, what are there any films that either you're involved with or you know people that are involved with should we be on the lookout for?
The Campground, the requel. Mm-hmm. That's one I'm looking forward to. That's actually Roman Josart's film. Mm-hmm. I'm a big fan of Roman in general. I love you, baby.
Oh, boy.
I know Roman's listening.
Okay.
Really, as far as indie films go, I've kind of been out of the loop just because I've been focusing on this for so long.
Yes, you have.
Green Inferno, that's a good one.
Okay.
That's considered an independent film, so I hear that's going to be good. There's a movie coming out, or actually it hit video on demand on the 18th called Cooties with Elijah Wood.
Oh, yeah.
I saw that. That was a fun, fun film.
I bet. I've been meaning to see it. I heard it looked pretty good.
Yeah. Never really pulled anything to chime while we still have.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. I have a couple questions. I'll make them quick. How was your guys' reaction, especially for you as a director, when a very great director himself, Wes Craven, passed away recently? How did you feel about that?
It's funny that, you know, as a horror filmmaker, you know, I spend so much time either working with death or talking about death, that when one of us dies, I mean, it's a shock to the world. It's one of those things. I remember waking up that morning. I went to bed early that night, and people started posting about it at about 10 or 11 p.m., and I woke up the next morning to all these texts from my friends and other filmmakers, like, oh, my God, Wes Craven's died. I think it was a big shock also that, I mean, nobody really knew that he was sick.
I know, I think that was the problem that everyone thought he died of old age.
Yeah.
No one knew that he died, that he had something going on that made him pass away.
Yeah. It was very sudden. I know it's affected a lot of filmmakers. I really don't know how to, I haven't processed it or haven't really tried to process it. I kind of pushed death away.
Right.
But I can tell you that I pay homage to him and several other filmmakers in this film. I've even got a video store scene to kind of pay homage to the Scream franchise.
Right.
Yeah.
And another question I have is, and it's a fun one for both of you, and for Dan, too, if he wants to chime in. What is your guys' favorite horror movie, like, if you had to guess, of all time?
Brittany, you're going first, because this is going to be good. This is going to be good.
Okay, well, I will always like the Stay Alive movie.
That movie was good.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because it was the first scary movie that, or horror film that I watched that, like, freaked me out.
Mm-hmm.
So I will always really like that one. That one will probably always be my favorite.
And for those who don't know what that movie is, check it out. The only detail I give you is about a video game.
It's pretty great.
It's pretty cool, though. All
right. Well, Liz, I got a tie for first. One is Dale and Tucker versus Evil, and the other one is the first Scream film.
Yeah. All right.
Those are good.
Oh, you've seen those.
I've seen both of those, actually.
Oh, yeah, they're excellent.
The entire Halloween franchise. That was my favorite horror movie growing up.
And a close second to me would be Cry Wolf. I thought that was excellent. Also, Bon Jovi was evil to the bone, just like real life. But that's neither here or there.
Sean, what would be yours?
I've been asked this question millions of times. I don't know how to answer it. I can break it down into genres. I guess I'd have to go with, as far as what I would feel my favorite film, horror film, has been, and it's just because I grew up with it, would be Monster Squad.
Okay.
I remember Monster Squad.
Like, that was, Me and my cousin wore out 3 copies of that tape from our local video store. Wow. I mean, Monster Squad was awesome. But what's funny is that at that age, I mean, I was probably 8, we watched Monster Squad and Sleepaway Camp 2 a lot.
Okay.
Which are like complete opposite ends of the spectrum as far as horror goes.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, I guess I have one last question for wrap this up. Do you have any goals for yourself? Like, even if you do this indie film, like, do you plan on going mainstream or wanting to win awards? What would you like to do for the rest of your career?
Wow. I don't know. I've never really thought about that. And it's funny because I just recently held an Academy Award and didn't even know it.
Brittany can answer this also if she wants. She has any vision for her career.
Well, since this is the first thing I've ever been in, I want to start getting more into it.
Okay.
Like, not just in front of the camera, but also behind the camera. And Sean already knows this, so I just want to kind of keep going. That would probably be where I'm at at this
moment.
Keep swimming.
Yeah.
Keep swimming.
All right. Well, that was it. Now, I guess, yeah, you got this film. We'll call it "Don't Fornicate in the Woods," but you do tour on it. So, where can people find out about your film, and where will you be promoting this film over the next few months, and when will it release? So, tell us all about this film that people need to know.
You can actually pre-order it right now at www.conceptmediallc.com.
Okay.
We have it on DVD, Blu-ray, and VHS, actually. Big okay. box VHS.
Mm-hmm.
Very retro. It's awesome. I can't remember the other questions that you just asked.
Well, that's fine, but are you guys going on tour to promote it some more? Because you've done conventions in other places. Are you going elsewhere before it comes out?
Not before it comes out. We're hoping to, other than people that have pre-ordered and backers from the fundraisers,
mm-hmm.
The next time that this will be available will be most likely March of 2016.
Awesome.
So we're going to kind of create a demand for it.
All right. Well, Sean and Brittany, good luck to you. I do want to buy this movie since it's been in my brain, and it'll make for a good Friday night once it does get in my hands.
And I want to watch it myself just to see if it gives you that horror film theme. Like, especially
yeah, when I'm curious.
An independent film. I'm hoping you guys do as great as like what John Carpenter did back in the 70s
with
this film.
All right, well, Sean, Brittany, thank you very much. And Brittany, you may not want to shower for a few days. Look at your forehead and take notes. Take some notes on your forehead. All right, thank you very much. This has been great. Thank you. All right, that was Shawn Burkett. And, of course, the actress, it was Brittany Blanton. And, of course, the rest of the cast. Chris Scott, he is listening. He was supposed to be Scott Gillespie. He's listening. He couldn't make it tonight. He was supposed to be part of the group, but that's fine. He's here in spirit. So, anyway, we're going to play some more Halloween music. And when I come back, I'll be back in about 12 minutes to end the show. I'll have my final message. So you must stay tuned for that. So, with that, you are listening to Ohio's on Fire. And this is WWSU 106.9 FM, Dane's Right Choice.
Congratulations, San Francisco! You've ruined pizza! Bust the Hawaiians! And now you!
Don't let your music go the way of broccoli pizza. Stay tuned to WWSU 106.9, Fairborn, Dayton, the un-broccoli pizza.
We are back with Ohio's on Fire. I am your host, Daniel Diesel. And I'm about to have a final message, but stay for next Tuesday night. I will try to have Cincinnati, Ohio Music Showcase. I'm stuttering my words for some reason. Anyway, live radio, but next week I'll have the Cincinnati, Ohio Music Showcase. Hopefully it should go through this time. And I will have guest Noah Ken. He is from the band Let Us Pray. He is a Prodigy music player from Springboro, Ohio. He'll also bring his brother. He's known as the Hitman, Aka Ammo. They will both be on next week. They'll talk about music in the family and other projects that they're on. And it'll be great. So that'll be next Tuesday night. So stay tuned for it. So check that out. It'll be awesome. So then it's time for the final message. And I'll be honest. I have a subject every week. And it's always something that's thoughtful and interesting. And I can think what I'm going to talk about this week is thoughtful and interesting.
But it might be boring because it's about sleeping. Yes. I want to talk to you about sleep. And it's really important because here's the thing. As a college student, I'm a very busy man. I am pretty much every day of my week while I'm in school, I'm either doing homework, I'm doing work for organizations, I'm trying to be a guest for Ohio Is On Fire, and I'm always trying to find ways to make myself a better person. I am up a very long time, and sometimes days can be very long and stressful. Sometimes there's good days. But there's always something at the end of your day, and that is sleep. And what it is, when you're sleeping at night, it should be your time. It's your time to realize that the day is over, and you have, it's 10 hours. Think about that. While you're up during the day, everything is really fast if you think about it. Like, you get up, eat breakfast, that takes about 10 minutes. Then you go up and do the next thing, and you got to take 30 minutes to do that. Brush your teeth, takes 5 minutes. Then I get on computer and try to book Ohio's on Fire. That might take an hour. Like, even the things that you think would take a long time, like, say if you want to study for your homework, or you got to study a script for an upcoming film, such as Shawn Burkett's upcoming film, that might take 3 hours, and those 3 hours you kind of wish would go fast enough, but they last a long, long time, very long and excruciating. There's that, then there's work. What if you worked a day job, 8 hours long, you standing up to pick up boxes and trash, doing that for 8 hours? That sounds like a long time. But then there's the beauty of sleep. You don't have to do anything. The day is over. You're not obligated to do nothing. And if you go to bed soon enough, you can have 10 hours of sleep. And that's actually my bad habits, because I want to do everything at once. And I usually stay up late on nights that I have to be up like 8 in the morning the next day. And I said, I can get by with 6 hours. And you know what? I mean that's fine. That's fine, I do that, and anyone else that does it, but every once in a while, you should look forward to sleep. You should look forward to dreaming. Try to go to bed at a good time, and sleep for a good 10 hours, maybe 11 hours. I think sleeping at 11 hours every once in a while. And think about what really makes you happy. Think about your fantasies. Think about a world where there's no stress, there's no hate, there's no fear, and everyone that you love loves you back. And you are with your real friends and your real family. Or just anything of things that you haven't done yet that doesn't exist in the real world, but exists in your dreams. Everyone does it. From a good person that, such as Mother Teresa, to the most evilest of people like Adolf Hitler. Everyone dreams. Everyone has that power. People disabled, people who have all their limbs, and people of all race, all genders. In between all the stuff you go through to live this life, we all can do one thing. At the end of the day, we get to close our eyes and be at rest. And that's actually a wonderful thing, because I can think when my grandma and my grandfather died, they both died in their sleep and they were very peaceful. It will happen one day, but that's ultimate. Just go to sleep, feeling love, be at peace. Be happy what you have, and wake up the next day, and go for something that's great. Ohio, that's the way it is.